डीएनए सीक्वेंसिंग इज अ प्रोसेस ऑफ डिटर्मिनिंग द ऑर्डर ऑफ न्यूक्लियोटाइड्स अलोंग द डीएनए स्ट्रैंड एंड वी ऑल नो द डीएनए इज कंपोज ऑफ शुगर एंड फॉस्फेट एज द बैकबोन एंड देन ऑन द शुगर्स आर अटैच ऑल द बेसिस. सो बिकॉज द शुगर फॉस्फेट बैकबोन इज नॉट चेंजिंग एट ऑल as far as the information in the DNA is concerned, that has to be present as the order of bases, and therefore knowing the order of bases is very crucial because that tells you what information the DNA is coding for. Okay, and therefore they say sequencing is fundamental for what you call a genome analysis and understanding biological systems in general and biological processes also in general. Okay, now the first method for sequencing DNA was actually invented way back in 1977. Okay, so 87 97, it's about 42 years now. Okay, by two people, almost one after the other, Sanger and Gilbert. But the two methods were very different in their approach. Gilbert's method was what is called as chemical degradation approach, and Sanger method was what is called as a dideoxy chain termination method. Okay, so imagine Watson and Crick actually gave the double helical structure in 53, but the way to determine sequences was only invented almost in 1977. Okay, now after that, for a while, not too much happened, and then in the initial things were automating of these techniques. But then, in 90s, newer techniques started coming. Okay, and then in this millennium, we got what is called as next generation sequencing, or what is called as fast sequencing. Okay, so we'll take a look at the sequencing methods so that you get a feel for how things are done. Okay. So we'll start with the traditional ones. The first I'm going to talk about is Maxim and Gilbert chemical sequencing, okay, and follow it up with Sanger, and take it from there. Okay, so what is Maxim and Gilbert sequencing method? It was developed in 1976-77 by Maxim, who was a graduate student of Walter Gilbert. Okay. And the basis of this method is that you do what is called as base specific partial chemical modification of DNA. Okay, and when we do this chemical modification of the base which is present on the DNA, that makes that DNA sensitive to cleavage where this base modification has occurred, and you use that to your advantage to generate very, very specific pieces of DNA. Okay, so here is a classic paper, 1977, February, of Proceedings of National Academy of Sciences. This is Walter Gilbert here, okay? And this is that classic paper. If anyone wants it, I've got a copy, okay? PDF of this new method of sequencing DNA, kind of like a very historical paper, okay? But see what they do in this method. What they do is, they first take the DNA whose sequence has to be determined and tag the 5' end, okay, or what you call as label the 5' end. The reason for labeling this DNA is so that I can follow this DNA and detect the DNA as it goes through all the procedures. Then I take the sample of DNA and I put it in four different test tubes, okay, and the same sample of DNA in the four different test tubes is subjected to different base modification reactions. Okay, and after these reactions occur, each reaction being different in a given tube, then you do what is called as a cleavage reaction. And when this happens, different size pieces are generated in the different test tubes because of the way the reaction occurred, and then you do gel electrophoresis to separate these pieces. Okay, now since most of the time the labeling is done using radioactive phosphorus, then you find out where the fragments are on the gel by doing what is called as radiography, by exposing the gel to a X-ray film, and the film will get exposed wherever the bands are, and then you will interpret the results. Okay. So to give an example, so this is the first step. This is a sequence that is unknown to me. Okay. So what I do is I heat this DNA, and it will become single strand. Okay. Now remember, I have a sample of this DNA, so millions of molecules of this double-stranded DNA, and when I generate, when I heat it, I'll generate double the amount of single-stranded DNA. Okay, so if I had one double-stranded DNA, I would have got two single-stranded DNA. If I had 1 million of these, I would have got 1 million each of these. Then what I do is I separate these two. Okay, and the way I separate these two is by running it on a gel. Okay. Typically, because each of those fragments contain different amounts of adenine and guanine relative to thymine and cytosine, the ones which contain purines tend to be heavier, okay, which are higher in purine content, and they tend to move little slowly through the gel because they are heavier as opposed to the other ones. Thus, able to separate the two single-stranded molecules, and then what you do is you tag one of those at the 5 prime end with 32 phosphorus, P32 phosphorus. And the way you do it is by taking radioactive ATP and using this enzyme, okay, this should be enzymatically, okay, using the enzyme called as kinase, okay, polynucleotide kinase. Okay, so what now you can do is this allows you to follow this fragment by having this radioactivity to track it. So you can, so this is like a tracer, as they call it. Now see what you do. In one test tube, you add only DMS. In another test tube, you add DMS plus formic acid. And remember, this test tube already has your DNA sample. Now, these two reactions, DMS and DMS plus formic acid, modify the purines. And what they do is basically methylate. Okay, see the reagent, dimethyl sulfate. They methylate adenine and guanine. Now something very interesting happens. If I treat only with DMS, only guanines are methylated. But when I treat with DMS plus formic acid, both guanines as well as adenines are methylated. Now once this methylation occurs, when I treat with piperidine, cleavage occurs exactly where the modification was done. Okay. So as an example, let us say this is a strand and I'm treating this with DMS, and remember DMS only, so it will modify guanine. So here is a modification reaction where this guanine is methylated. As soon as this methylation occurs, this makes the DNA susceptible. So the first thing that happens is this guanine leaves, so you get depurination, and then in the presence of piperidine, the DNA breaks at this point where the guanine was. So now remember, this is a 5 prime end and this is P32 here. So that P32 is still going to be here and you'll detect this piece here, CNA. Okay. And by detecting this piece here, you know that the next was a G because you're treated with DMS. Okay. Now, you adjust the concentration of DMS in such a way that you don't get cleavage to a full extent. So the concentration is such that you get cleavage at random here and there. So sometimes what will happen, you'll get modification here, and when that happens, it'll break here and I'll get a 4 base containing piece which is radioactive, which will be C, A, G, and T. Okay. So all such reactions, permutation combinations will occur because I have controlled the concentration of DMS. And in the other case, when I have DMS plus formic acid, then the cleavage might occur here or here or here or here, and I'll generate pieces of different sizes. Okay, so in that test tube which has got DMS and formic acid, I'll get a piece which has got only C, I'll get a piece which has got C and A, I'll get a piece which has got C, A, G, and T. Okay, then I'll have a piece which has got C, A, G, T, and G, C because it cuts here. Okay, so the idea is to generate all these different types of pieces. Likewise, in the other two test tubes, to treat with hydrazine or hydrazine presence of sodium chloride. Now there again, you have selective cutting in one case only at where C is and the other case where C and T is. And again, when you treat with piperidine, the bond breaks exactly where the modification was done. But hydrazine does the interesting modification, is actually ring opens the pyrimidine ring. Okay. So after this is done, you take all the samples in the four test tubes and do a gel electrophoresis. And if you remember, gel electrophoresis will separate based on size. So the smallest fragment will move fastest and the longest fragment will move slowest. Now remember, as these fragments run, okay, usually there will be like four lanes, one for each test tube. One will be for DMS, second will be for DMS plus formic acid, third will be hydrazine, fourth will be hydrazine plus NaCl. And after you run, what you do is take the gel and expose it to that X-ray film to know where the radioactive bands are. Now this is the fine details. If I remember, DMS methylates adenine. It methylates adenine and this nitrogen here and makes it susceptible for dechlorination. And it modifies guanine at N7 here. Okay. Similarly, hydrazine takes this pyrimidine ring and makes it smaller. Okay. And not only that, it makes it very unstable. So, and therefore link DNA what do you call, strand cleavage occurs at that point. Okay. So now these are all very detailed reactions of what exactly happened. Maybe not needed now, but in case somebody is interested, I'll give it to you. So as an example, let us say this was a piece which I was trying to sequence. Okay. Now remember, I've cut it with four different reagents such that they cut wherever there was A and G, they'll cut wherever there was G, they'll cut wherever there was C and wherever there was CT. Now, one thing you notice, all the reagents which cut here when there is a pyrimidine will generate pieces which are not the same as the reagent which cuts where the purines are. Okay. So, if you look at this side here, no, all the pieces that you have generated, their run is very different from the pieces here. Okay. And the reason is these are all sites where pyrimidines were. These are all sites where purines were. Okay. Now see what happens in the test tube where the cut is every time there is a A or G. Okay. So the first cut will be right here and the phosphorus will disappear. And when that happens, you'll not be able to detect anything. Okay. Now the second cut occurs where there is a A, right? So I'll get a piece which is G, C, and T. Okay. That is this one. See, three bases. G, C, and T. Then I'll get a piece which is G, C, T, A, and C, which is 5, which is there. And the interesting thing is this piece will be also seen in this test tube where the reagent cuts out at where the G was. Okay. So this will be shared by the two tubes. Further, again, there'll be a piece which is G, C, T, A, C, G, T, which is 7, which is where the A was. Okay. So I get a piece here. So now very interestingly, if I compare the sizes of pieces in these two lanes, wherever I see pieces both places, I know that was a G. Where I saw only in one lane, I know that was a A. Likewise here, you get C and T. So wherever things are in common, it is C here. And wherever things are alone, it is a T. Now all I have to do is know which lane is for which reagent. And then I can just read the sequence directly. I can say here both were present, so it's a C. Here present only here, T. Here it was present in the A and G lane, so it is A. Here it is present in the C and C plus T lane, so it's a C. Here it's a G and G plus A lane, so it's a G. And so on and so forth. And I get my sequence directly. Okay. And I have successfully got the sequence. Okay. Now, the only problem with the Maxim-Gilbert technique, other than it being direct and accurate, is you use lots of toxic chemicals and you use radioactivity. Okay. And setting up these reactions is not easy. Okay. Sometimes if you don't add enough reagent, you don't get modification on all the bases. If you have too much reagent, it will cut everywhere. And it has got a limit. You cannot use it for DNA pieces which are more than 500 base pairs. And you'll never know which is the first nucleotide of the sequence. Remember, when this gets cut, you lose phosphorus, but you don't know what it was here, whether it was G or C or T or A, because that piece will never appear, okay, in the actually this thing, okay. Is that clear? So at that same time, look at that, in December, about 10 months after that other paper, Sanger came up with this variation of a method called Sanger dideoxy. Okay, now what is this method? This method is very interesting. It uses enzyme-based, sequencing. Okay, it's called a PCR-based, but it's actually also called PCR or DNA polymerase-based method. Okay, so what you do here is you actually replicate the DNA whose sequence you are trying to find out, but you do the replication in a very controlled fashion. Okay, and you do the replication in the presence of very specific dideoxy nucleotides. Okay, so what are these dideoxy nucleotides? Normally in DNA, you have deoxy nucleotides where OH is not present in the 2' position of the sugar. Okay, in dideoxy, even the OH which is present at 3' is removed. Okay, so what happens because of this is that when these nucleotides are recognized by the polymerase and added to the growing DNA chain because of the activity of the polymerase, if this is added, then polymerization continues. But if this is added, because there is no OH here, further bases cannot be added and the chain simply stops there. Okay, and that is shown here. Okay, so for example, this is a template. The template has T, C, and G. And you know, whenever there is a T, the polymerase will bring an A. And wherever there is a C, the polymerase will bring a G. And then add them together to give a phosphodiester bond. Okay, now look at this G. It has got an OH here that sets it up for reaction with the next C which comes in because the template has a G. Okay, so this OH will attack this phosphate. This pyrophosphate will be removed and I'll get a chain which grows in this direction. But what happens if instead of a regular GTP, I put a dideoxy GTP? Then what happens? This reaction occurs, the joining occurs, but then because there is no OH here, this chain cannot continue, the chain will simply terminate. Okay? And we use this phenomena to our advantage. Okay? So what is done in this case? Again, you get your source DNA. You again aliquote it into 4 test tubes. Okay, but see how these 4 test tubes are set up. In all the test tubes, there will be a polymerase, either TAC polymerase or DNA polymerase. In all the test tubes, there will be a primer so that a DNA polymerase can add to the primer. And then you'll also put your template, the DNA whose sequence you want to find out, okay, in each of the test tubes. Then you add all the nucleotide triphosphate, okay, so that polymerization can occur. And now this is a kicker. And then you add in all the 4 individual tubes, 1 of the 4 dideoxy. So let us say test tube 1 will have only dideoxy ATP. Test tube 2 will have only dideoxy GTP and so on and so forth. And then you allow the polymerization to occur. Or that is what they say, run the PCR or run the polymerization. Now what will happen is because of the presence of these dideoxy fellows, in those tubes which contain those dideoxy analogs, there will be some pieces which are formed which are not complete, where they have been terminated because of the addition of the dideoxy nucleotide. So it is this different pieces that you generate which are used to then allow you to sequence. Okay, so what you do is, here it is shown here. I have my unknown piece of DNA here. I put it in all the test tubes. In all the test tubes, I put a little primer. What is this primer for? So that the polymerase can add to it. So if I know there is ACAA here, then I make a primer which is T, T, G, and T. T, T, G, and T. So the primer will sit here. And then when I add the polymerase, it will start to add all the nucleotides based on what is there. So if there's a G, it will add a C. If there's a C, they'll add a G, and so on and so forth. So in order for that to occur, I also put all the nucleotides that are needed by the polymerase. But then see what I do. In this, I put dideoxy ATP. So what will happen in this test tube? Whenever there's a need to add A, okay, that means when the template has a T, I'll need to add an A. The A I add could be a regular A or a dideoxy A. If I add regular A, the chain will continue. But if I add dideoxy A, the chain will stop here. The same thing will occur here and here. Okay, the way I set up the reaction is adjust the concentration of dideoxy ATP so that it is such that sometimes it will stop here, sometimes it will stop here, sometimes it will stop here. I never add it in excess so that I'll terminate the first time I see an A. Okay, so I adjust my concentration. So all pieces are generated. Likewise, it will occur at every T requiring place here, at every G requiring place here, and every C requiring. Now you will realize now that in every tube now, the pieces you will generate will be different in length. Okay, and that is what is used to your advantage. Okay, so for example, here is an example where I have a dideoxy C. So if I encounter a G and if I add dideoxy C, I'll get a piece of this length, it will not go any further. If I add a regular C, the polymerase will continue till it enters G. And when it sees this G, then it can add a regular C or a dideoxy C. If it has dideoxy C, I'll get a piece stopping here. Otherwise, the DNA polymerase will go all till the end and finish the synthesis. Okay. So that is the philosophy of the Sanger dideoxy method. And see how I read the sequence. So if this is an unknown sequence, what I'll find is in all those tubes which are dideoxy GTP shown here in G here, I'll generate pieces which are the shortest here, moves the fastest. Then a piece which is kind of intermediate in length, which is here, and a piece which is slightly bigger than that, which is here. The biggest piece will be generated in the tube which has a A, or I have to add a T, and that is shown here. And that T containing tube will also have a piece which is here. Okay. Now, very interestingly, you'll realize that every piece is in a different test tube. Okay, no test tube has got pieces which are shared by any other test tube. Okay, and then I can read the sequence directly. So if I realize this is where the G is, right? So I say, this is where there was a G, then an A, then a C, T, G, A, C, G, T. And then I realize that this G is being added to this C, right? And then A is being added to this T. So all I do is I flip the sequence over and look at what is called a complementary sequence, and that tells me the actual sequence of the DNA strand. So if you see A, G, C, T, T, see that A, G, C, T, T. But what runs on the gel is complementary. The great method works very nicely and has been used like a workhorse. Okay. Now, as of today, you will find that Maxim Gilbert is also almost obsolete. Nobody uses it. But Sanger method is used widely, okay, because people are very comfortable with it. In fact, the method is so good that it is used to actually validate all other newer methods. Okay. But the problem with Sanger method is it is slow. It takes time. You cannot rush it. Okay. And again, here also, if you have bases which are more than 900 base pairs or something like that, then it doesn't seem to work. Okay. Now, for both of these things, Gilbert as well as Sanger was awarded the Nobel Prize in 80. Okay. Now remember, the technique was invented in 77. In 3 years, the committee of the Nobel Prize thought it worth to give them a prize for the importance of the technique. Now, on that year, the prize was also shared 50-50 with Paul Berg. So it's interesting, Paul Berg got half the money and Gilbert and Sanger got quarter. And what did he do? He gave us the, the cut and paste technology, as it's called, of recombinant DNA. Okay. So, and then, as time progressed, people tried to automate the Sanger's method. So see how they automated the Sanger's method. They use what are called as fluorescent labeled bases. Okay. Now, typically, the automation technique tends to use what is called a dye terminator, where a little color is put wherever the dideoxy adenine is going to add, or say dideoxy guanine is going to add, or dideoxy thymine is going to add, or dideoxy cytidine. But the fluorescent tag that is put is different for each and every base. Okay, so here I've shown A is blue. Okay, just what blue means is that it will fluoresce at a certain wavelength. Similarly, if it had been a DDG, it would fluoresce at a different wavelength. So basically what I can do now is I can distinguish this, which base got added at the end of the piece by simply looking at the fluorescence. Okay. Now, the advantage of that is that after I run the gel and try to read what is coming like this, all I can do is now mix all of them, because see, wherever the strands have ended with a G, they'll have a different colored fluorescent tag. Wherever the strands have ended with a dideoxy A, they'll get a different tag. Shown here, for example, that where dideoxy A was added, it is green. Where dideoxy G was added, it is black. Where dideoxy T was added, it is red. And where dideoxy C was added, it is blue. So what I do is I mix them all and run it through a single column and look at which color is coming out as I do fluorescence testing. So if I see fluorescence of green, okay, which means a certain wavelength, I know that was where A was added. So I can actually read the sequence as these bases come out of the column and fluoresce. So when green comes out, I know it was A, then G, then T, then C, then T, then G, and so on and so forth. And that is how we do automation. Okay. So as the bases come out, you get a readout. So the first readout will be the smallest piece, and the last readout will be the largest piece. Okay. So you see green, black, then red, 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 black. So that will show up like this on the chromatogram. Okay. And that is called the electroferrogram. And you can directly read the sequence. Okay. Now this is what is called as automation. Okay. Now, even though it is automated, it is still slow. Okay. And for a while, that used to be the biggest drawback of Sanger sequencing. But even though it was good, even though it was automated, it was slow. So there was a need now to do something about it. Okay. And this is a summary of what I just said. And the need was to do something fast. And there came what is called as next generation sequencing, which is also called as massively parallel sequencing. Okay. So now here, the beauty of this technique is you can actually sequence large numbers of different DNA samples at the same time. Okay. So I do not worry technically about purifying my piece, making sure no contamination is there. I can actually mix different pieces and sequence all of them at the same time. Okay. Not only that, as the sequencing occurs, the recording also done concomitantly of all the samples. Okay. So you will get a lot of signals where different sequencing reactions are occurring, and all of them are generating data, and all the data is recorded. Okay. And basically, in order to do this very efficiently, you need what is called as miniature detector, a miniaturization of the sequencer itself, and very sensitive detector. Okay. So these are common features of what is called as NGS, next generation sequencing. But see, how do you get that speed? Okay. Now there are some steps when you do what is called as this new sequencing. One is isolation and purification of DNA. Okay. Now this purification of DNA is different from the fact that I can do multiple samples at the same time. Okay. Here I have to want to make sure that the sequence of the piece I'm getting is a single entity and not multiple entities with different sequences. Then you do what is called as a library construction, where you cut out this genomic DNA and then tag them, okay, basically label them. And after that is done, you partition these fragments at different places on what is called as a sequencer flow cell. So this flow cell, which is where the sequencing reactions are going to occur ultimately, also has places where you can do some reactions, okay. And these are nano cells, okay. So they're very tiny, hold very little sample, but there are millions of them on a flow cell. Okay. And at each of those places, you create what are called as clonal clusters. Okay. And I'll tell you what these things are a little later. And then you sequence each cluster simultaneously. Okay. Now see how we do it. The first part that you have got your genomic DNA and you're going to break it apart. Okay. Now this breaking is typically done in most cases by using what is called as sonication, or running the DNA through a very small bore size needle, or what is called as shearing. Okay. So when you do this, your one sample of DNA, which has got millions of copies of the same sequences, is going to be broken down into small pieces at random. Okay. And because you're not using an enzyme and you're using just sonication or shear, DNA is going to break wherever possible, and you're going to generate lot of permutation combinations of pieces which belong to the same essential big sequence. Okay. Now, once you do that, what you do is you tag them, okay, and see how the tagging is done. Okay. Now, when you do ultrasonification or what is called a shearing, you will generate pieces which have got a lot of damages to the end. Okay. There will be some base pairs missing. Okay. Here it is at this end, here it is at this end, here it is at both end, here it is all correct. Now, what you want to do is make sure I repair these errors. So, in order to repair those errors, what I do is I add what is called as DNA polymerase T7. What this does is wherever it sees a gap, it fills it. Okay. So, for example, if this was an A and this was an A and there is nothing here, it will add a TNT. If this is a G and C, it will add a CNG and so on and so forth. And it'll make all the sequences, flush and correct. Okay. And after that, this other enzyme comes called as clonopolymerase. And this is very interesting. It adds a single A to the 3' end. Okay. So you see this A at the end, it adds a single A. Okay. And because it adds a single A, you'll find that in this DNA, in this side here, A has got nothing to pair with. And here A has got nothing to pair with. Okay, normally it will pair with T. Okay, so all the pieces now will have a little overhang, as it is called, but it's a single A overhang. At the same time, this T4 kinase comes in and it adds a phosphate to the 5' end. Okay, we saw this reaction when we were labeling. So now what will happen is all the pieces that you get will be perfect as far as the ends are concerned. They'll all have phosphates at the 5' end. And each will have an A overhang. Now you do something interesting. You add specific adapters whose sequences you can control. And you know, and you add it so that they will ligate to the both ends. And the way you design the adapter is the adapter has an extra T. So when it has an extra T, what will happen? This adapter will nicely, for example, let me take this adapter. It'll go here and sit here so that A and T can base pair. And then these two strands will be here. And it will be joined by a ligase. So essentially, what will I have now is all my DNA. These sequences may be different, but they will have the same tag at both the ends. Okay. So, and this tag which I put is a very controlled tag, and it has a certain function. Okay. What you call as the adapter. Okay. Now, there's another way you can do this in one shot. Okay. And this doing it in one shot is done by an enzyme, which plays a role in what is called as jumping genes. You must have heard when you did your DNA replication, etc., that you also have some situations where genes from one part of the chromosome suddenly jump and go to another part of the chromosome. And these reactions are catalyzed by what are called as transposonases. Okay, and these pieces of genes which can jump are called as transposons. Now, what people have done is isolated one of those enzymes from this transposonase complex. And this enzyme has got a unique property. It will cut DNA kind of randomly into pieces of around 500 base pairs. And if you give it adapter sequences, it will also put it at the end. Okay. It is just like it is taking this piece and it is putting it here and here. Okay. Like a transposon activity it will do. So here, essentially what I showed before is done, but using an enzyme. Again, these adapters are very controlled adapters, okay, of a certain sequence. And they have a very specific function. Okay. Now, the adapter has got three functions. One part is complementary to the sequences on the flow cell. Okay. Remember I told you the next step would be where these things are going to be sent to the flow cell for sequencing. Okay. So, one part of the adapter is complementary to the sequences of the flow cell. The second part is a barcode index for sample identification. So, for example, what I might do is I can put some base sequence and say, okay, this base sequence I'm going to use every time I'm sampling, let us say, Sandhya's DNA. At the same time, let us say I'm sampling Deepali's DNA. When I take her DNA and cut it up, I'll put an adapter which has got a different 6-bar that will tell me all these pieces are from Deepali's sample. Okay, so I can tag them. And the third is a complementary sequence to the primer, which is sets the tag up for amplification. Okay, rather than figuring it out here, I'll show it to you. Okay, so Here is how the adapters look. So the piece of interest, the sequencing is here in gray, okay, in the middle. And this is the tag which has got three things here, okay. And the tags on this side are different from tags on this side, okay. Now in the previous examples, I showed as if the tags are same on both sides, but actually speaking, the tags are different on both sides. Okay. Now just for example, see on the flow cell, there might be a piece which is like this, red, in the 5 prime to 3 prime. Essentially, this piece here is complementary to this piece, okay? Which means if I were to take this DNA here and separate it to two single strands and I throw it at this flow cell here, this will complementary base pair here, okay? And I'll be able to set this one here, okay? Not only that, see this part which is yellow, it is complementary to this sequence, okay? So it will set it up so that not only this part binds here, the primer for the sequencing step is complementary to this. So that's why this is called as a primer binding sequence. Similarly, on that flow cell, there will be another place where there is a black base, which is 5 prime to 3 prime, and that is designed to bind to this strand here. See this 3 prime to 5 prime orientation. So essentially, I can bind both the strands through their 3 prime end to the 5 prime end of two probes which I put on the flow cell. Okay? Now, after I do this, I separate this double-stranded DNA into single strands and I throw it at this flow cell. Okay? And I partition it. That is what it is called. Okay? So when I partition the fragments, they'll go to different locations on the flow cell. Okay? When they go to different locations in the flow cell, depending on what is where, at some places this will tag here, at some places where there is a black, this strand will hybridize, okay? And you'll get these links there. And then you do what is called as amplification, okay? Now, before I do that, the flow cell, as I told you, is acrylamide coated glass cell. It has got numerous identical oligonucleotides of two types. Okay, remember there are actually one red and one black. Okay, I can also put different colors like green and pink. This is what I just said. So, these are the two strands. Remember, for the two strands, if you remember, were complementary like this. Black ends are complementary and the red ends are complementary in the original strand. Now, when they separate, see what happens. This red is binding here. This red is normally was bound to this part here. Okay. Because this is a 5 prime orientation of this double strand. Now, that has a black one which orients correctly here. Okay, now see the beauty. Here I've got a piece which has got a primer here, which has got a 3 prime over here. So now when I add DNA polymerase and all nucleotides, what will happen is this will start copying. This will start copying this DNA all the way to this end and essentially make a complementary copy of this DNA. And that complementary copy is nothing but this piece, okay? But in the opposite orientation. At the same time, there's also a primer here. When I have DNA polymerase and the nucleotide, this will start sequencing this. And what I'll get is a complementary sequence to this, which is actually exactly identical to this, okay? But the beauty is that this DNA now is covalently attached at this flow cell. And this DNA is also covalently attached to the flow cell. Now, if I were to heat and let this original strands go, they will disappear. But all that information now is present on the flow cell on these tags which I have added. Okay? And then I do the next step. So this is how this flow cell looks. Okay? So you have to realize that these are all very, very small. There are these numerous nanowells. And what I'm talking about is happening at all of these nanowells. Okay, and there are, this is a, you know, a kind of a euphemism here, but there will be millions of these nanowells here, not like, you know, hundreds, okay. And the higher the sequencing capacity of the sequencer, the bigger is the flow cell, okay. Now this is one of the smaller ones. The bigger flow cells are probably about 5 times the length of this one here, okay. And then see what happens. As I told you, you have generated this strand, right? This complementary strand. Then I heat and I separate these strands which have come in to bind to them. So this black and the red will disappear, and now, as I told you, this one and this one have got the information of all their original DNA, but now attached to the flow cell. Okay, and now if you want to look at all the articles of next generation sequencing, they'll say now this DNA will bend and you'll get amplification, and it will not make sense to you what exactly they are saying. Okay, so I made a little cartoon here with some bases. Okay, and this is the picture you'll see, that lot of amplification will occur. They call this bridge amplification, and then you'll get the same sequences in an amplified manner, and it will not be clear immediately what they are saying. Okay, and now here is an example, and we'll get back to that. Let us say, for example, this is your DNA of interest, and you have added these adapters here. Okay, and when you add this adapter, see what happens to this DNA. This is 5' T, and at the end also there is T. And in this DNA here, 5' is A, at the end is also A. You know, if I were to heat this double-stranded DNA, I'll get these two single-stranded pieces, okay? One with all the A's here and all the T's at the end. Now remember, on the flow cell, I have pieces that I put which are exactly complementary to this end here, which read A from 5' to 3 and read T from 5' to 3. Why have I made them? So that these pieces will go and hybridize. Okay. So see what happens now when I throw them. They'll go on this flow cell and see this piece here. It went and hybridized to the A primer. Remember, there are two types of primer. The other type of primer is a T primer, to which this other strand came and hybridized. Okay. Now I add my polymerase, and when I add my polymerase, it will complementary synthesize this strand. Likewise, it will also complementary synthesize this strand. Okay. I missed the line here. See, this is AAA, so it is TTTT line. Okay. So this is also actually a line here. Okay. It's just missing it. Okay. Now, after I do that, what I do is I heat and I denature the two, and what will happen is this A here will disappear and this T here will disappear, okay, because they will run away, they are not tied to the flow cell. So what I end up getting is this, but if you notice carefully, this is the exact same sequence which was already there in my original. Okay, so what I have done is basically captured my sequence DNA on the flow cell. Okay, now see the interesting part. See, this end is T, and at some other place there are A's like this, and the orientation is opposite, 5' to 3, and this is 3' to 5. So this can kind of bend over here and actually bind to this primer. Likewise, this can bend over and bind to this primer. Okay, and see what happens there. This will bend over like this. But now look at the situation here. I have a primer which has got a free OH group here, and here also I have a primer which has got a free OH group. So when I add DNA polymerase, it will read this strand and will simply make a complementary strand all the way coming down. Okay. Here also all the way kind of coming down. Okay. So what I'll get now is a complementary strand. Okay. Now the beauty is this. If I were to heat this one, the two strands will separate, but they will not disappear. They'll still stay on the flow cell because both the strands are attached to the flow cell. So essentially, now I've got this. So what I've done by doing this procedure, I've amplified, right? I originally had only one strand each of the original. Now I've got two. Now when I leave this alone, this will again bend. This will bend and will find an A. This will bend and will find an T. This will also find a T. Then I add DNA polymerase. I keep on amplifying it. So in this local region, I'll only have these two sequences. Okay, because they cannot go any farther, because in the nanowell, they are limited by the length of the strand. Okay, and these lengths are around 200 bases, so it can't go far and go to another cell. Okay, so at the end, what will have? I have an amplified piece. Okay, now such amplification can also be done in what is called as a emulsion form, a bead. Okay, this is another way to amplify. They put primers on the bead and they do the same thing. Okay, take this and this will bend here, this will have the other sequence, and now you'll get U structures and you keep on amplifying. And this is called emulsion amplification. Okay, so essentially what happens is, after a while, at each nanowell, you'll get the same type of DNA. Remember, one is the original sequence, one is a complementary sequence. Now, when I want to sequence, what I do is I very systematically remove one probe from it, so that I have only one of the sequences, okay? And all these sequences are identical now, okay? Now you realize that at this end also, I've got a sequence which I can use to my advantage by putting a primer, okay? So when I add a primer which can bind to this end here, the primer will sit here and there'll be a OH end facing this way. And I can now add a polymerase and will synthesize the strand in this manner. But when I do this reaction, I do it in a controlled fashion, and that reaction is called as sequencing by synthesis. Okay, now see what exactly is done now. Once I have amplified and I got these strands here, now see what happens. I use to my advantage this primer here, and I put a complementary primer, and then I introduce all the bases which are tagged differently. You see these tags? A has got a green tag, C has got a blue tag, T has got a red tag, G has got a brown tag. So when I add DNA polymerase and I introduce all of these bases, at one position only T will bind. And when T binds, I'll find that this new strand that I've made will have a red fluorescence. Okay? Now the trick I do is I do not allow this reaction to occur, next reaction to occur, till I've read this red color. So when I do the reaction is polymerase, T will get added and then the reaction will stop, and then I turn off my detector and see what color got added, and I detect it as red. Then what I do is I do a little reaction where this T will now be amenable to the addition of the next base, which is G, okay? And then when G comes in, I'll detect it as a green signal. After I detect the green signal, I'll allow the A to come. And when A comes in, I'll detect G comes, I'll get a brown signal. And when A comes, I'll get a green signal. Okay, so as I do one reaction, I detect what color is coming through, okay? Now, this is one way to do it. The other way is to do it by what is called as pyrosequencing. So what is pyrosequencing? Every time a base gets added to DNA, it releases pyrophosphate. Remember, when nucleotide triphosphates come and they become part of the chain, you release pyrophosphate. This pyrophosphate is trapped by a compound called APS, adenosine phosphosulfate. And it is trapped by this enzyme called ATP sulfurase. What it does is basically forms a bond between the pyrophosphate and the phosphate and releases sulfate at the same time. So it converts APS to ATP. So every time a base is added and a pyrophosphate is released, I trap that pyrophosphate and I make ATP out of it. Okay? Now, I do this reaction very intelligently. I only throw, for example, GTP and I see whether pyrophosphate release occurs. If it occurs, then I know G got added. If pyrophosphate release is not there, I know G didn't get added, then I add A. If I see pyrophosphate release, I know A got added, and so on and so forth. Okay. Now, how do I detect this ATP? I detect this ATP by reacting it with a compound called luciferin in the presence of an enzyme luciferase. And when that ATP reacts with luciferin, it generates oxyluciferin and a quanta of light. So I can detect this light, and that's why it is called as pyrosequencing for two reasons. One, pyro because pyrophosphate is released, and second, pyro because we use the word pyro when we talk about light and fire. Okay, so kind of a pun, pyrosequencing, because it not only gives you light but also throws out pyrophosphate. So see this example here. I have a green, right? So green is complementary to blue. So when blue comes in, pyrophosphate will be released and I'll detect that as light. When any other base will come, I'll not detect light. Okay. Now, the problem with this technology, it was great, is that if I have a string of greens, what will happen, a string of blues will be added one after the other, because in this there is nothing stopping the addition of the next base. So when I have five or six greens, it starts creating an error, because it is unable to figure out how many pyrophosphates were released, because the light now gets kind of difficult to measure, whether it is 6 times the normal or 5 times the normal, and so on and so forth. Okay, so that technique, even though it was very popular, got actually replaced by this Illumina technique. And this Illumina technique is the one which I talked about. It uses triphosphates with a dye which is colored in the base, and also it has got a blocking group. Okay, so when I add all the bases, what will happen? One of the base will come here, which is complementary to this. For example, if this is C and this is G, G will come, G will give me a blue color, but G cannot be used to do any further addition because this group is blocked here. So after I read the blue color, what I do is I unblock that and I make it OH, and then I'll find C will come and give me a red color. And I then measure the red color, then open the C up so that the next base can be added. So as I'm synthesizing this sequence, I'm also sequencing it. That's why it is called as sequencing by synthesis. Now, the way I talk takes time, but this occurs very, very fast in the instrument. Okay, and so fast, and because you have cut pieces at random, you'll find when you look at the sequencing information, no, lot of pieces will have what is called overlapping sequences. And what you do is typically take a computer and tell it to run all of these pieces, and it'll line everything up. And all you have to do now is now look at all these pieces, and each one is acting as a control for the other in a sense. Okay. For example, if so many pieces line up and everywhere this is A, I'm so confident that this is A because I've read it 10 times. Similarly, here I've got less confidence because I've read 9 times. Here I'm least confident because there are only two fragments where this showed up. Then one is a C and one is a G. Okay. So now I have a doubt. Okay, what is here? Okay, but here I have no doubt. But the beauty is, this is the original sequence. I can easily determine that sequence by lining up these cells. Okay. Now we don't do it physically. Computer algorithms do it very, very fast for you. Okay. But the beauty is that if I want to typically do a genome, okay, I cannot read that genome once. Okay, just like in our lab, we do n is equal to 6. When I do genome sequencing, I end up doing what is called as n is equal to 20, okay, or 30. I keep on reading the sequence again and again so that I make sure there are no errors. Okay, so if you look at the human genome, if I do this, it'll be 3,191,490 pages of data. Okay, and this type of data will consume 80 to 19 gigabytes. Okay, but analysis is also not easy. It requires very high level of computing as well as storage, but those are all there now. Okay, and we are able to do it without a problem. Okay, now even this sequencing has some issues, because in lot of genomes there are a lot of sequences which are repeated many times, what you call as DNA repeats. Okay, tandem repeats. Now when there are a lot of repeats, then what happens is, when the computer starts to align these repeated sequences, it cannot figure out how many repeats are there. It tells you there are repeats, but it cannot really tell you whether there are 100 repeats or 200 repeats, because at a lot of places, though, you'll find the piece is so big that it is coming in common many times. So you don't know whether it's a middle piece or a left piece or a right piece, because the sequence is exactly the same all through. Okay. Now, those things are being taken care of by a new third generation sequencing, which we may discuss a little later. Okay. So we are at that stage now. But in addition to these two and the ones which I talked to you, Pyro and what is called Illumina, there are other sequencing techniques also which are very interesting. Now, what has this done? See this, in 2000, when we tried to sequence the human genome, the cost of sequencing the human genome was $100 million. Okay. And that stayed like that for a little while. But as newer and newer techniques came and automation came in, suddenly the price dropped. And it dropped so drastically that in 2014, the cost of sequencing a human genome was only about $8,000. And very interestingly, in 2019, it's only about $1,000. In fact, they predict that in a couple of years, the cost of sequencing a genome will be about $100. Now, $1,000 is affordable to many people. Okay, so you can get your genome sequence, and the beauty is you can get your genome sequence very quickly. Now, if you look at Sanger sequencing, even with automation, for doing the human genome required hundreds of scientists, hundreds of machines, 3 billion and about 10 years. But next generation came in. Initially, the cost dropped drastically to 5,000 and the time to 2 weeks. And the number of people, 1 to 2 to 1. But now with the third generation or even better sequencing, the expected cost is 1,000 or less and the time is a few hours. So it's just a matter of time now that you will find the DNA genomes are sequenced left and right. Look at some of the dreams people are having. The city of Dubai plans to sequence all of its population of 5 million. City of Nanking in China is planning to sequence its 1 million people. Okay, totally 1 million human genomes have been sequenced so far. Okay, different people have got their, you know, genome sequence. Okay, so now sky is the limit, because in a day now you can sequence a genome without a problem. And the more genomes you sequence, the more differences in people you can find out, and you can know what are the reasons for certain properties, certain diseases, certain traits, and use this then in order to improve our healthcare systems and treatment protocol. Okay, so I'm going to stop here. Okay, so if anybody has any questions at this point, I've talked something which is very off the cuff, very different, but I thought that you should know, okay, all of these things, because sometimes just knowing things only in DMPK is not enough. And now, tomorrow you might discover a new P450 and you might want to sequence it, okay, to know whether it is new or not, to know how to classify it. So you need to know how people do sequencing. Here I talked about genome sequencing, but sequencing of individual genes is equally important. Okay, so that you know what are the polymorphisms, you know of DNA 2D6 polymorphism, where it is occurring, how it is occurring, how do they do that, how do they sequence and find out. Okay, so this is for that. Okay, so I'm going to stop sharing and see if you have any questions. Okay. Okay, let me go back. Okay, any questions? Hello, is everyone there or? Any questions? So this is not DMPK, so now you have to think hard what questions you have.
Hello, sir.
Yeah, yeah.
So, sir, I don't know if I understood correctly, but in the Sanger's method, when you put the initial primer, you say that it's complementary. So, in that case, you need to be knowing what are the first three, what would be the
first. Okay, yeah. Typically, what is done is that. Now, if you remember that I can add adapters at the end, which I showed you when I did next generation sequencing.
Yeah.
Okay. You can do that even to your unknown sequence. Okay. So when I have an unknown piece of DNA, I want to sequence. What I do is I add a tag at the end. Okay. And since this tag is known to me, what I've added, I can also make a complementary sequence to that tag. Okay. And that complementary sequence will act as a primer. And then I'll be able to know what is the actual sequence of my DNA. Okay? So usually that piece at the end is actually not piece of your unknown DNA. Unknown DNA starts from where the first addition will occur to the primer.
Okay, so it's a known thing for which you are adding a primer.
Exactly, exactly.
Okay.
So there's a step you do. You cut your DNA up to small manageable pieces, because if you remember, Sanger techniques is able to only do about 900 bases at one time. Anything more, it starts making an error. So you cut your pieces to that size, and then before you start sequencing, you put little tags at the end.
Okay.
Once you put a tag at the end, and when you separate the DNA, you can use one of those tags as a place where the primer will sit.
Primer joins. Okay.
Okay. So the primer will be common, okay, to the sample.
Okay. Thank you.
Now, in the same breath, your Maxim Gilbert technique never needed a primer, okay? Because it just took the DNA and it cut it. So that was a big advantage, that technique. But the problem with Sanger is a lot of toxic chemicals, radioactivity, and it's the reaction is very tricky to do, okay? Although the I explained, add hydrazine and add DMS, there's a temperature requirement, there's a time requirement. All these are very, very tricky. And if you don't do it correctly, then you don't get reproducible results. And sometimes some pieces which were not generated, they get generated. And, so, and things go wrong. So that's what people don't use. Yeah. But this next generation sequencings are amazing. They will take, you know, just one piece if you have, they'll amplify it at one location. The reason you want to amplify is so that you can get enough signal to detect. Okay, so you must be wondering, why do I do an amplification before I do the actual sequencing by synthesis? The reason is that if I have only one strand and I'm adding one base to it, the amount of fluorescent light I will generate is very little.
Hmm.
So what I do is I amplify in that region. So all the sequences there are the same. Okay, and then when all the sequences G is added, the signal I generate, which is a blue, is much more and easily detectable. That's why amplification is crucial for the success of NGS. But the beautiful thing is that each little nano well, amplification occurs of almost like one piece. Okay, so everything there is data of one piece. Right next to it is data of another piece. Right next to it, data is of another random piece. So this detector, I've got a lot of this, CCD cameras, okay? So the detector comes in, after you add a base, it takes a picture all through the flow cell, what color there is, records it. Then it adds another one, then it records it. And then all these pictures are kind of lined up in chronology.
I was wondering how is the light then interpreted further.
Yeah, so that camera will take pictures in like a time-lapse fashion. Okay. One base added, photograph. Second base added, photograph. And then this photograph will be read in sequence to see what color appeared at each time, and that will give you a direct readout of the base. Okay. And this reading is occurring at many places simultaneously. Okay. So there's like thousands and thousands of reads which are occurring at the same time. Okay.
Yeah.
And you deconvolute that data. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Any other question? Even if it is costly, realizing that the cost of genome sequencing is come down to $1,000, the instrument probably pays for itself over time. And because these are all nanocells, the reagents which are used are in minuscule quantities. The reagents are also not toxic. And there is no need of radioactivity. So that brings down the cost very significantly. And again, it is done all by one or two people. So there is not too much manpower cost. There is not too much, you know, overhead cost. So everything is miniaturized, small volumes. That is what makes it fascinating. Okay.
Hello.
Hello, hello.
Sir, Girish here.
Yeah, Girish. Roll along.
Sir, actually, I was interested in knowing, you said that we adjust the concentration of dideoxy nucleotides in such a way that you actually get the full sequence, but then you stop in. Yeah.
Yeah, you get all the possible pieces.
You said that there is a varying concentration of DD ATPs in all the four test tubes. So
No, no,
actually I was
it is not
interested.
varying concentration of DDP, right? You have to
Conditions, yeah.
ATP. Okay.
Adjusting conditions.
See,
Yeah.
all the four test tubes have high concentrations of the regular nucleotides. Okay. There is deoxy ATP, deoxy TTP, deoxy CTP, and deoxy GTP. But in all the four test tubes, we have, relatively speaking, lower concentration of an individual dideoxy. For example, test tube A will have a small concentration of dideoxy. In test tube 2, it will be small concentration of dideoxy GTP, and so on and so forth. Now, when I put a small concentration, what happens is whenever there is competition, say between regular deoxy ATP and dideoxy, most of the time regular will go. But once in a while, dideoxy will go. When dideoxy goes, that train will stop there. Now, if I do the reverse, see what happens. If I add an excess of dideoxy ATP, what will happen? Every time the requirement is for A, chances of dideoxy going there will be more. So what I'll do is I'll keep on generating very, very small pieces, and I'll never get a feel for the whole sequence. So that's why I have to put limiting concentration of the dideoxy so that it gets added once in a while. Okay, when that happens, then at every place there's a potential for A to go, there's a probability of deoxy A of going, and therefore I generate all the possible pieces. Does that make sense?
Okay. Yeah, sir. Thank you.
At one time that used to be the research, but now when you sequence, all these things are so well known that once you know how much quantity of DNA you're adding, you can actually do it like a cookbook. ऐसा रेसिपी जैसा आता है कि इतना डीएनए लो, इतना ये बेस डालो, इतना वो बेस डालो, एंड यू कैन डू इट इन अ वेरी कट एंड ड्राई फैशन. एनी अदर क्वेश्चन? ओके. इफ नॉट कैन यू स्टॉप हियर फॉर द डे? And we'll meet again next week, hopefully. ठीक है? Bye, everyone.
बाय
Take care,
सर,
take
टेक केयर।
care,
बाय
take
सर,
care,
बाय
everyone.
सर,
Bye. Hope you enjoyed this
टेक केयर।
different talk today. Okay, a little
यस
different, but
सर,
added to
यस
your
सर,
GK as they call it. ठीक है?
यस सर,
चलो, bye.
बाय
Bye bye.
सर।